Very important case in a number of respects, not least the fact that the opinion that everyone looks to, the Jackson opinion, was by Justice Jackson, who was, of course, FDR's Attorney General and certainly a proponent of expansive executive powers.
But you've also said he's one of the justices you admire the most.
He is, for a number of reasons. And what's significant about that aspect of his career is here's someone whose job it was to promote and defend an expansive view of executive power as Attorney General, which he did very effectively. And then when he went on the court, as you can tell from his decision in Youngstown, he took an entirely different view of a lot of issues. In one famous case, even disagreeing with one of his own prior opinions, and wrote a long opinion about how he can't believe he once held those views. I think it's very important.
Are you sending us a message?
Well, I'm just saying, one reason people admire Justice Jackson so much is that although he had strong views as Attorney General, he recognized when he became a member of the Supreme Court that his job had changed, and he was not the president's lawyer. He was not the chief lawyer in the executive branch. He was a justice sitting in review of some of the decisions of the executive, and he took a different perspective. And that's, again, one reason many admire him, including myself. In Justice Jackson's concurring opinion, which is the opinion that has sort of set the stage for subsequent cases, analyzes the issue in terms of one of three categories. If the president is acting in an area where Congress is supportive, expressly supportive of his action, the president's power is at its maximum. If the president is acting in an area such as you postulate under the Bybee memo, where the president is acting contrary to congressional authority, what Justice Jackson said is the president's authority is at its lowest ebb. It consists solely of his authority under the Constitution, less whatever authority Congress has. That Justice Jackson is making there is that the Constitution vests pertinent authority in these areas in both branches. The president is the commander-in-chief, and that meant something to the founders. On the other hand, as you just quoted, Congress has the authority to issue regulations governing the armed forces, another express provision in the Constitution. Those two can conflict if by regulating, making regulations for the armed forces, Congress does something that interferes with, in the president's view, his command authority. And in some cases, those disputes will be resolved in court, as they were in the Youngstown case. Harken back to the model I was talking about earlier of Justice Jackson, who went from being FDR's Attorney General to being a justice on the court who I think always had a healthy regard for the prerogatives of the legislative branch. I hope we haven't gotten to the point where Supreme Court's opinions are so abstruse that the educated layperson can't pick them up and read them and understand them. You shouldn't have to be a lawyer to understand what the Supreme Court opinions mean. One of the reasons I've given previously for admiring Justice Jackson is he was one of the best writers the court has ever had. And I think you didn't have to be a lawyer to pick up one of his opinions and understand exactly what his reasoning is and why he's saying that. And if he's citing and relying on precedents, he can cites them and explains them. They're not written in jargon or legalese, but an educated person whose life, after all, is being affected by these decisions can pick them up and read them, and you don't have to hire a lawyer to tell you what it means. I hope we haven't gotten to a point where that's an unattainable ideal.
Says, when the president acts pursuant to an express or implied authorization of Congress, his authority is at the maximum, for it includes all that he possesses in his own right, plus all that Congress can delegate. A seizure executed by the president pursuant to an act of Congress would be supported by the strongest of presumptions and the widest latitude of judicial interpretation, and the burden of persuasion would rest heavily upon any who may attack. Do you agree with that?
That was read from the Jackson opinion. I do. I agree with the basic proposition that the president's authority is at its greatest when he has the support of Congress. And this is where you get back to the Youngstown analysis, where Justice Jackson said there are three categories. You can act with Congress's support, with being unclear what Congress's position is, and he recognized a third category where you can act, the executive may act in the face of a congressional prohibition. And there are certain areas where the executive does have authority to the exclusion of Congress, you know, without stating a legal view. For example, one that law professors regularly talk about is the pardon power. In other words, that's given expressly to the president under the Constitution. And restrictions, if Congress were to pass a restriction on the pardon power, does the president nonetheless have the authority to act under the Constitution? That's a difficult question, but it may be that the president's authority would trump Congress's authority. So I can't answer a question in view of the proper role of a judge in our system. And people have different answers to that question. I've given an answer to that question. How do you approach particular cases in areas of particular interest? And I've been asked that question, and I've given an answer. I've explained, for example, in the area of executive power, as issues arise, what would the framework that I would use would be. And I've talked about the Youngstown opinion and Justice Jackson's framework there. I've talked about how I would approach cases involving the right to privacy under the Liberty Clause. I've talked about how I would approach cases